Get college credit for the program you're about to see. Call the City Colleges of Chicago at 977-2525 and sign up for History 243.
Paul Newman, Secret Desires, today, 3:30.
Semester. Produced in association with Bergen Community College, Paramus, New Jersey, presents Asia, Half the Human Race. Part 1, Asia, Past and Future. Today's topic, Roots of Modern Asia, the North and East. With Dr. Robert B. Oxnam, Director of the Asia Society's Washington Center and China Council. Dr. Oxnam.
In the last couple of programs, we found that while many Asians share common problems and similar aspirations, Asia does not form a single geographical unit. Instead, we found several different regions that make up the islands and continent that we call Asia: the Northeast, the Southeast, and the South. Today, we're going to tighten our focus a bit and explore one region, Northeast Asia, leaving South and Southeast Asia to the next couple of programs. Within the northern and eastern regions of Asia, we find the most populous area in the world. 1 billion people in China, 115 million in Japan, 50 million in the two Koreas, 18 million in Taiwan, 4 million in Hong Kong. Even more remarkable is the fact that these huge populations are supported by relatively small amounts of arable land. The most prevalent crop is rice, which is grown in flooded paddy fields like the one shown in this photograph, requiring huge amounts of labor and producing sometimes up to 3 crops a year. In broad historical terms, Northeast Asia is often called the Chinese world because of the strong cultural influences of China. Chinese civilization, which dates back over 4,000 years, eventually had its impact on all of the other countries around it, on Japan, on Vietnam, on Korea. One example is seen in this painting. In the heyday of the Chinese Empire, the emperor received annual tribute missions from the outlying countries, considered barbarians in traditional Chinese terms, and in return, the barbarians were permitted to trade. These tributary missions increased the flow of Chinese culture to the outside world, including Chinese art and literature, the Chinese philosophy of Confucianism, the Chinese language, and even Chinese cuisine. But the Chinese influence was like both poles of a magnet, both pulling and repelling the countries around China. The Japanese responded to these pressures by selecting and refining certain features of Chinese civilization, such as Chan Buddhism, which became Zen Buddhism in Japanese translation, and mixing them with certain features which were Japanese alone, such as the samurai warrior tradition represented in this painting. In more recent history, each of the countries of Northeast Asia has followed its own path to nationalism and modernization. Indeed, as a result of these differences, we have often seen tensions and even warfare in the region. Witness the two Sino-Japanese wars, the Korean conflict, and the continuing conflicts between China and Vietnam. But there's one remarkable feature that all of these countries have in common, and that is their rapid economic growth and foreign trade, which is most noticeable in the countries of Japan, South Korea, Taiwan, and Hong Kong, and increasingly noticeable within China itself. To help us look at this broad region of Northeast Asia, we have with us today a noted expert on China and Japan, Professor Ezra Vogel of Harvard University. Welcome.
Thank you, Bob.
Maybe we could start out, before we turn to North and East Asia, with a question about Asian studies in this country. The viewers know that you're a professor at Harvard and that your expertise is in both China and Japan, and therefore you have a rather unique vantage point to look across the country and see how well equipped we are to study Asia. Could you comment a bit about where do we stand in terms of Asian studies?
Well, in the case of East Asia, we really have a more complete written record to go on than any other part of the world. Korean genealogies, are, for example, are by far the best genealogies we have of any country in the world. The Chinese court kept daily records for a couple thousand years, and a very high proportion of those daily records are still available for scholarship. Japan had comparable written records that go way back a couple thousand years. And it's really only in the last couple decades that we've begun, with modern scholarly techniques and command of the language, to really go through these records. And what we've had for the last couple decades, I think, is really an exciting new look of people competent to do the study, beginning to go through the historical record, to beginning to catch up with the studies that have been done in Europe. In the case of Japan, we have an enormous advantage because the Japanese themselves have done so much to pull together collections, to go over the collections, to write indices, and to engage in secondary scholarship that makes it very easy for Americans. On the other hand, in China, the Chinese scholarship has really lagged behind, and I think it will take several months.